This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today we have two truly remarkable guests on Dreamland. Terry Lovelace, you know. Terry has been with us in Terry, what I regard as one of the most accomplished close encounter witnesses in the world. He is well known for his skill in interaction with the visitors. We have a new guest today. This is a very extraordinary guest. He's written a really extraordinary book. In 2015, Matthew Roberts was a U.S. Naval Service member stationed on board the USS Theodore Roosevelt. The events that transpired during their 2015 workup cycle, that is to say the when they were preparing to go out on deployment, brought the first ever declassified footage of unidentified aerial phenomena, and the New York Times article entitled Glowing Auras and Black Money, the Pentagon's Mysterious UFO Program by Leslie Keene Ralph Blumenthal then made history. Subsequently, Matthew transferred to the Office of Naval Intelligence in Washington, D.C., and so did the phenomenon. He began to have frequent and often intense personal experiences with it. This is why his book is called Initiation. This is about what's really going on, I think, more than perhaps any show we've ever done. And we're going to go through this with Matthew and Terry today. It's going to be a truly remarkable journey, because this is not about aliens landing on the White House lawn and giving us cell phones with anti-gravity elements in them or perpetual batteries. It's about us. It is about exactly what Matthew is calling it, initiation. But before we begin, Terry has a lot going on. First of all, Terry, I want you to tell us about your book and tell us where you're going to be this summer, the same place I am at Contact in the Desert. So why don't you tell us all of these things?
Sure, and thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I wrote Incident at Devil's Den back in 2018. I'm happy to say it's been well received. I wrote the second book called Devil's Den, The Reckoning, in December of 2020. Both are available on Amazon. I have an audiobook for Incident at Devil's Den. And this June, the 25th through the 28th, I'm going to be at Contact in the Desert for their virtual conference. And they have an amazing lineup of people. It should be a very good show. We won't be attending in person this year, but I think it'll be the way it's set up with a program called Observation Deck. I think it's going to be a very interesting conference. And I will have a workshop there, an experiencer workshop, where for people that think they may have been abducted or are just curious, I can go through some of the commonalities that people have reported to me and share what I know and what I've experienced. So hope to see you there.
I'm going to be there too. I will have a lecture and a workshop also. Hopefully not the same time Terry does. but in any case, my lecture is going to be reviewing. First, we're going to review some unusual UFO footage that virtually nobody has ever seen before. Among the things we will be reviewing is the single best piece of UFO footage in private hands, and the most extraordinary one, the only one ever taken through a Celestron telescope. And it's going to be very interesting. I don't think so far, although this may not be true by the time you see this show, there has been a release of official release of video as good as the one that I will be showing. And then for my workshop, I'm going to go deeper into the stresses and struggles of the close encounter witness and what it's like to be in this experience. Now, it's a perfect time to go to our first question for Matthew. And now, well, actually, Terry, I think maybe the best first question is for you, because you're here for some reason that, and you, it's because you have met and helped Terry a great deal. Can you tell us a little bit about how that happened?
Yeah. Matthew called me back in 2018 and he read my book, Incident at Devil's Den, and recognized that we had some things in common. We were both, he was active duty at the time. I was active duty from 1973 to 1979. In the epilogue of my book, I put an email address and Matthew reached out to me and we eventually made a contact by telephone and had about an amazing hour and a half conversation. And I recognized that what Matthew experienced and how he could articulate his experience was very important. And he had already made his decision to write a book, but I encouraged him to do that. And the book is a wonderful, wonderful read.
It sure
it's
is.
Amazing. There's nothing like it, I promise you.
That you don't, yeah, he's right, folks. There is nothing like this book in this world. And it's terribly important because it comes from one of the members of the military who had this experience. And in that regard, Matthew, take us back to that day in 2015 when your life changed.
Yeah, so we had just finished our workup cycle, and I was just kind of sitting back, taking a deep breath, because for the past month we had been undergoing tests and trials out at sea. So I was sitting back, taking a breath, deep breath, and one of my friends walked in from another area on the ship. He also worked in intel, but he worked closer with the pilots. And he came in and said, "Hey, check this out." So I pulled it up on my screen, in my shop, and, I watched what everybody now knows as the gimbal footage and the go fast footage. Actually, I saw them both at that time.
And what was your reaction?
I thought it was, incredible. I mean, it was just the most incredible thing I've ever seen. I couldn't make sense of it. I had a very powerful emotional reaction to it. Throughout the course of the next several days, I started to feel like they were there for me. And that feeling was very powerful. I later started to think that I was getting paranoid that people would find out that they were there for me. At the time I didn't understand this. I lost my appetite completely. I wasn't able to eat for several days. So I had this very, very emotional reaction to it that I didn't understand at the time.
Terry, take us back to your experience in Arkansas, the Devil's Den experience. Your reaction was very similar in many ways. In other words, you're post the experience, you had a kind of an inner struggle, as I recall. Post your experience at the...
I did.
The campsite. Yeah.
Yes, you're coming in very garbled on my end.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, you guys froze for a second. And then, I'll go ahead and push ahead. You might want to re-ask that question, though, because I don't know if it's going to come across, if it came across.
Well, no, the recordings, I can edit this out easily. We don't have to keep talking.
Okay.
The recordings are... on our personal computers, and the recordings will be beautiful, but sometimes the internet makes us a little hard for us to hear and see each other.
Okay.
But what it does is it records on your computer and then sends that to its servers after we're finished, and it's beautiful. Okay. So let me do this. Let me pause for a minute and re-ask the question.
Okay. I appreciate that.
Terry, your experience in Arkansas happened at a place called Devil's Den, actually, and it was on a camping trip. Your reaction to it afterwards was really kind of similar to Matthew's in many ways. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think it was similar in a lot of ways. My friend and I saw something we didn't understand. We had an experience that confirmed, validated for us that, you know, we're not, humanity is not the be-all, end-all, that we're not at the top of the food chain, that there are entities out there that are living, sentient, and many rungs up the evolutionary ladder from us. Afterward, I had struggles too. I had bouts of depression. I had trouble sleeping. I had a roller coaster of emotions that lasted about 6 months. I credit my wife, who was very supportive, as she still is, with getting me through that. I was 22 years old at the time. I never planned to write a book or make a disclosure about this until, really 2012. In 2016, when I started writing the book, all that anxiety resurfaced when I started writing the book, and I felt guilty. I felt like I was revealing some kind of family secret. And I experienced a dramatic weight loss and had that loss of appetite. And so, yeah, anytime there's interaction with them, I had anxiety afterward.
Yeah. The same as me. I mean, we all did. And Terry and I were lucky and privileged to have wives who helped us bring it together again, and who were with us and stayed on side. Matthew, can you explain what you did on the ship? What was your job?
I was a cryptologist on the ship. And that is what I had done in the Navy for 16 years. And so cryptology is just, a subset of intel.
Okay. So you were basically, decoding, your job was decoding signals from, say, if the ship was on deployment and there were signals from other ships or possibly enemy signals or that you might pick up, you would try to decode them.
Well, I mean, I can't really get into everything that was.
Okay, I'm sorry. I won't go down that path. So you see the footage, you react, you're really strung out. We all have these moments of discovery. Now, Matthew, you stay on the carrier, or do you leave the carrier? What do you do? Because I know in the Navy you can request deployment changes.
Yeah, I didn't request any kind of change. It was just my normal rotation came up after deployment. And I ended up doing a hull swap with George Washington, and then my normal rotation a year later sent me to the Office of Naval Intelligence.
So you were on the carrier for quite a while after the incident.
Yeah, we went on a deployment after that,
right.
And it was around the world, 9-month deployment. So during that time. During that time, I found myself pulling up this footage and watching it over and over again, to the point that coworkers, I remember watching it one day and some people came in behind me and they were like, "Are you watching that again? What are you doing?" You know? And I just thought, how could you not be watching this? You know, I didn't get that.
Yeah. Did you talk to any of the pilots who had made the footage, who'd seen the things?
No, I never spoke to any of them. But I did, you know, at the time the incident was happening, I had walked past two of the pilots standing in a doorway, and they were talking about it. And one of them said, "Oh, did you see the UFO videos?" You know, and I, being paranoid about people finding out that they were there for me, I just threw my stare at the floor and just walked past them as quickly as I could. I didn't want anything to do with that.
Do you have the sense? Well, you know, speaking of sense, folks, I have a piece of very good sense for the free Dreamlanders. It is that you should definitely do what we tell you in the commercials you're about to see and or hear. We'll be right back.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
There was an incredible UFO wave going on back in 2007. Forgotten all about it? Well, we haven't on unknowncountry.com, and you can still explore it with one of the leading experts who was involved personally, Brian Vike. Listen to this.
My good friend of mine, he's in the UK, believe it or not, and of course I'm in Canada, and between the two of us, just two of us, we pulled in. Now this is going to be a rough one. I think I stopped it at 434 reported sightings for Canada alone in 2007.
This is an excerpt from one of literally more than 1,000 different episodes of our various podcasts on unknowncountry.com. But how do you access them? We have a powerful search engine that enables you to access them by subject. But now also, when you go to the podcast drop-down menu, you will see at the bottom, podcast archive. This takes you to lists of all of our podcasts organized by year. And you can click on any year and browse through everything that's in that year for that podcast. This is a huge website, and we work more every day to make it accessible. For example, subscribers can now listen to the subscriber version of Dreamland on an app. There are a number of apps out there that will accommodate this, and subscribers will find more information about it in the subscriber section of unknowncountry.com on the Dreamland page. So for this and so much more, the time to subscribe to unknowncountry.com is right now. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe to this website. We need you. And I can assure you, you need us.
We're talking to Matthew Roberts. His new book, Initiated, incredible. And Terry Lovelace, author of Incident at Devil's Den. Terry's website is terrylovelace.com. We're both going to be at Contact in the Desert, the virtual Contact in the Desert, on the weekend of June, I believe, 21st. And is that the correct weekend?
I think it is June 25th through 28th.
25th. I'm going to write that down because I have to do so many conferences. That's easy to get the dates wrong. All right. So we'll both be there, and I hope you'll be there too and listening to our presentations. Now, Matthew, let me ask you another interesting question that will be interesting to a lot of the listeners who are also close encounter witnesses. People who are close encounter witnesses tend to move around a lot. I'm not a big mover. Anne was, though, and she moved us 11 times during her life. And now I'm here in the same apartment where she passed on, and I intend to stay here. But how about you, the two of you? Terry, have you done a bit of moving or not?
I did a lot of moving as a child, as growing up. My father was just we would move just a few blocks over to a different house. And
was your father in the military?
He was, and he was in the intelligence community. So
you suppose he was exposed to this in some way?
I do. I think so.
Mine was, I'm pretty sure, too. My uncle, his brother, certainly was, because he was involved in the Roswell incident. I wonder, well, how about your background, Matthew? You've done a bit of moving, I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, I've moved around just with the military, but I've never done any moves outside of that.
Yeah.
I mean, you transfer every 3 years anyway, so you can expect to move every 3 years.
So in other words, your movement hasn't been something that's kind of compulsive like Ann's and Terry's.
Right.
My wife didn't have any apparent experiences, but she certainly moved a lot. And there's a sense of unease under the surface in people. I think, Terry, the best indication that your father may have been exposed to this was the fact that he moved so much.
I think so, too.
Yeah, absolutely. So so we have that, and something keeps people on the run. Now, Matthew, you are on the deployment for 9 months. You're obsessing about the Gimbal footage and the other footage. You believe that this is somehow connected with you, but you don't know why you even think that, right? I mean, you just can't.
Oh yeah, I mean, that emotional reaction I had to it, to me at the time, I remembered thinking, well, that's crazy. I don't know anything about this. I've never encountered this before. You know, I don't. So it was a bit of a mystery to me as to why I had that emotional reaction to it.
Yeah. So now you end up at the Office of Naval Intelligence. Your deployment ends after 9 months, and you're transferred in the course of ordinary Navy affairs to the Office of Naval Intelligence at the Pentagon. And what happens next, Matthew?
So next, that's when just after I got there is when the New York Times article hit and the footage was released to the public. And that was kind of really the catalyst that started things moving. And I started to have just very personal experiences with the phenomenon after that.
You had an illness too.
Yes. As soon as I got there, I was short of breath. And one night I woke up in the middle of the night and I could not catch my breath. I felt like I had been running a marathon. It was a bit of a shock to wake up to be so out of breath. And so I tried to reach for my cell phone. But before I could do that, the room just went dark and I lost consciousness. The next morning I went to medical and, that's when they found I had a massive saddle pulmonary embolism, which are blood clots in the lungs. So I spent a bit of time in the ICU after that.
Do they know why this happened to you?
They don't. I had a clot that was in the back of my knee, and that was where the clots had come from.
Yeah,
but they aren't sure why this happened to me all of a sudden. The same thing happened to my brother actually years ago.
It's a familial thing. It's not related to this experience in any way that anyone can tell.
Right. Not that anyone can tell. But I don't know. I don't know, because I was tested for the genetic clotting disorders that are known, and I tested negative for all of them. So I'm not exactly sure what caused that.
Yeah. Well, so you end up, I guess, on blood thinners then. You're probably still on them.
Yes. I have to take blood thinners now for the rest of my life as a result of that. Because
happened to your naval career?
And, as a result of being on blood thinners, I was told that I would never be able to deploy again. Because obviously, if something were to happen, I were to get injured, I could bleed out very easily. So I had to go before a medical board, and they had to review my case to see whether or not I could stay in the Navy.
Now, life under the surface was changing a lot. You found this presence kind of in the shadows of your life. And tell us, you began to engage with it, or perhaps the other way around, it began to engage with you. Tell us about what began to happen, because you really went into a state of deep depression. And I'm going to quote something from the book. And I'm going to ask you a little bit about this afterwards. You said, "I was becoming depressed, severely depressed." And boy, I mean, I hear you, man. I went through that too. I nearly committed suicide. I believe you did too, Terry. We became incredibly depressed. And I'm sure a lot of the listeners are saying, "Yeah, boy, that happened to me too." It's very unsettling. It takes the rug out from under you, kind of. Anyway, here's what this book is a treasure in the sense that it takes you through. You would think, someone in the Navy, a cryptographer, would have a very technological kind of experience of this or vision of it, but that's very far from the truth here. I think, and I thought to myself when I read this book, I think, now I understand why the visitors went to the Navy, and the Navy's, because this is a guy who's telling it like it is. He knows what this is actually about. Okay, he's reaching the depths of despair, and then he starts to study, and he reads this in a book called by a woman called Mabel Collins. The book is called When the Sun Moves Northward, The Way of Initiation. The first time the disciple is consciously aware of it, the suffering is terrible because it seems to be a final state. It is known as the ceremony of terror, and the two stanzas of the birth litany belong to it. I am nothing save a fragment to be burned and consumed. I alone am as nothing. Can you tell us what your state of mind and your experience was that took you to this quote?
So the initial experience and the thing that brought me to that, not only that book but several others, was a very paranormal experience in which a specific book was basically placed in my lap, and said, "Here, read this." So one night, the article had been released in the New York Times, so I decided to drill down on who was involved with To the Stars Academy of Arts and Science. I knew these people were from the Pentagon. They were credible people. And so I decided to see who had written books in this organization. So I read Tom DeLonge's books. I read The Hunt for the Skinwalker by Colm Kelleher. I then read some Jacques Vallée because he had written the foreword to Tom DeLonge's books. And at this point, I'm running out of credible sources of material to read. So I decided I was just going to have to wait, but that wasn't good enough. So I decided, you know, at the end of Tom DeLonge's books, he talks about these tablets. And these tablets are ancient tablets of some kind. So I started looking this up on my phone one night to try and figure out what these tablets are. And so for some reason, in looking up tablets, I came across the Emerald Tablets, which are, you know, the tablets of Thoth. They talk about hermetic teachings. So I started looking up hermetic teaching, and I came across this book called The Kybalion by the Three Initiates. And so in looking at this, I read the synopsis for The Kybalion, and it talks about how there's no such thing as coincidence and that everything happens for a reason. And that the biggest problem, this is the biggest problem people have with the book, because it seems to imply that we have no free will. So I decided I'm not going to read it. You know, it just didn't seem like something I wanted to read. I then looked up to see if there was maybe a MUFON organization near me that I could join. And there was nothing that I was seeing online that wasn't 10 years old. So I thought, you know, I guess I am going to have to wait for more releases of information from TTSA. And I went to bed that night. The next morning, I woke up and I had to go to Pax River to sign some paperwork about how I had been found fit to remain in the Navy after my medical emergency. So I'm driving back to DC. It's like an hour and a half away. And on my way back, this hatchback cuts me off, and there's this large graphic on the back that says MUFON Maryland, find us on Facebook. So I thought, well, you know, I guess that's why I didn't find anything about them last night, because I don't do Facebook. Being in Intel, Facebook was not something I was comfortable.
No, having. I don't think so.
Right. So, you know, I just as this hatchback is in front of me, I notice I'm passing a Hobby Lobby, and I had never actually seen a Hobby Lobby store before. And I was familiar, you know, with the controversy and the Supreme Court decision that had happened surrounding that business.
So I go on about my way.
I get home, later that night. I'm about to go to bed, and I have to walk in front of, my roommate who's watching TV to head up the stairs, and go to bed. So as I'm walking in front of the TV, he says, you know what's wrong with these Republicans? And I said, no, what? And he said, Hobby Lobby. And then he started going into how this Supreme Court decision had allowed dirty money into campaigns and blah, blah, blah. So I talked to him about that for a few minutes. And then I went up to my room and closed the door. And I started thinking, you know, last night I had looked for a MUFON group, and then that hatchback cut me off today. And then I saw the Hobby Lobby, and my roommate just mentioned that out of nowhere. I said, this is strange, you know? So I noticed that my heart had started pounding in my chest. It was almost like, you know, when you get a rush of adrenaline, but there was no adrenaline. I just felt that pounding of my heart in my chest. And I thought, oh, geez, this is the blood clots coming back. So I sat down for a minute to see if it would go away. And then I started to feel this powerful urge to get in my car and drive. And that was not something I had ever felt before, an urge to go drive. But it wasn't going away, and I had sat there for several minutes to see if it would just subside, and it did not. So I decided I'll do this. I'll go drive, and I'll see that this is some wild goose chase in my own head. So I go downstairs, I get in my truck, and start the truck. I back out into the first point of the 3-point turn to get out of the driveway, and I stopped and I thought to myself, you know, it's like 11:30 now. I got to go to work tomorrow. If I do this, it's never going to end. I'm going to end up in a straitjacket. And I thought, you know, you have been reading these books and they're creepy and this is getting to you and it's all in your head, you know? So I thought, well, you know, I'm just going to forget about it. I'm going to pull back into the driveway and just go to bed. but when I did that, when I thought that, I immediately felt this feeling of electrical shock shoot through my body. I felt like I was attached to a light switch and somebody had just flipped it, you know. I could feel this electrical buzzing just through my entire body, and my hands turned the steering wheel towards the road and my foot stepped on the gas. And so I was headed out.
Okay, we have come up on a break. And folks, you're going to hear a really interesting story after this break. We're leaving Matthew headed out in the middle of the night on a very strange journey. It's a journey that's been taken by quite a few people. If you read in the communion letters, you will find more than one story of a person who suddenly had to go out and do this. And there's the classic 2005 experience of Corina Sables in British Columbia. She was on Dreamland, and she's written, I'm sure there's a book about it on Amazon. And she had that same thing happen. She suddenly had to go out in the middle of the night. And we're going to find out what happened to Matthew when we get back.
Contact in the Desert 2021. The journey continues.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds the fabric of space itself, how it's made. What is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
Contact in the Desert 2021 goes virtual. Go to contactinthedesert.com to find out more. My most recent three books, Afterlife Revolution, A New World, and Jesus, A New Vision, are a series designed to lead to a rich and useful experience of contact for us. Afterlife Revolution starts the series by showing that what we call the dead still exist and can and will become part of our lives as companions and teachers of a whole new kind. A New World's central theme is about the relationship between us and the presence, which includes our visitors, our dead, and other aspects of consciousness that we perhaps cannot describe in words. It discusses the deepest meaning of communion between us and them. It is frank about the dangers and plain-spoken about the methods. The third book, Jesus, A New Vision, is there for people who are not involved with religion, and for those who are, too, of course, so that they can gain access to the teaching of Jesus about how to live with and for the good, for it is living in this way, as an ally of the good, that we can form our relationship with our visitors into something valuable to us. If you have not read all three books, I urge you now to get the ones you haven't read, listen to them on audio, read them on Kindle or in paper form, however you prefer. They are part of our way forward, each of them in its own way.
We're talking to Matthew Roberts and Terry Lovelace. Matthew's book is Initiated. Terry will be at the Contact in the Desert conference with me, a virtual conference, the weekend of June the 25th. We both have presentations, and you're not to miss either presentation. And if we both present at the same time, the beauty of virtual is that you can watch the other one at a different time. So, and also Terry's website is terrylovelace.com. Now, before we return to what happened to Matthew as he got in that car and drove out into the night, Terry, what is your reaction to what's happening to Matthew now? Your struggle wasn't exactly the same, but it, like mine, it was very similar in many ways. The depression, the not understanding what's going on, and the eventual change. Tell us about that struggle a little bit.
Yeah, that struggle spanned years. And while I never got in an automobile and went for a drive, I, over the years, have got out of bed in the middle of the night, 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, gone outside, walked around, looked at the moon, came back inside, went back to bed. Would wake up in the morning and really had no memory of it until I found, you know, grass clippings in my bed because I went out in my bare feet.
Yeah.
And I actually had that happen in 2019, and took my phone with me and took a photograph of the moon. And there's some anomalies in it, just to the left of the moon in the picture. And I gave the footage to Linda Moulton Howe. It's a Apple video or shot, but it's actually broken up into segments. So it plays like a short snippet of a video. And
yeah.
So that's been my experience, but not in an automobile.
You know, interestingly enough, the other night I had an experience with my wife, which I often have, and the moon played a big role in that. There were two moons in the thing, and I've been wondering what was going on. Was this just a dream, or it seemed like a real experience? And so there's something. I'm not going to go down the road of the mystery of the moon and its relationship to all of this, but it's there. It's definitely there. A lot of witnesses have experiences that are somehow connected to the moon. Okay, moon or no moon, Matthew, let's go back. You're in your car. You're driving down the road to somewhere. What happens next?
Yeah, so I didn't know where I was going. I had no kind of sense of where I was supposed to go. So I figured I'd head down to Pax River again. It was kind of a rural area. So I, just before I hit the freeway, I stopped at this gas station, right by the freeway to, grab a drink, 'cause I wasn't sure how long this was going to take. And then, as I parked my truck, my heart starts pounding again, and this feeling washes over me that whatever I was made to leave my house for was going to happen right here at this gas station. So, I, you know, start to panic a little bit. I'm thinking, what is going to happen at a gas station in the middle of the night? Nothing good, probably.
I think not.
Yeah. I mean, I thought, is somebody going to start shooting? Am I supposed to die here? What is this? You know, this is crazy. So I'm scanning the gas station to see if I can figure out what I'm supposed to see. And then I see it sitting at a table right out front. There's a homeless man sitting there who's clearly homeless. I mean, I could see that from across the parking lot. And he was sitting with these two women who were dressed very well, immaculately, in professional business attire. And so I recognize this.
No sense.
Yeah, yeah. It's a gas station near the freeway in the middle of the night. And these two just immaculately dressed businesswomen are sitting with a homeless man. And it was definitely out of place. And I thought, well, this has got to be it, because this is so clearly not supposed to be happening. I mean, they were dressed so well that they look like the women I worked with at work, that maybe
Congress or something like that, you know?
So, yeah. You know, I'm sitting there in my truck and I'm a little bit reluctant to get out. And I hear this voice very loudly and very sternly say, "Get out."
In your head.
Yeah, I think so. Well, I mean,
or in your ear. You can't sometimes, folks, as yeah. many of you know, you can't actually tell where that voice is coming from. But go ahead. And it's harsh. Get out. Right. Yeah, yeah, I've heard that. A lot of people have. Go ahead.
Yeah, so I kind of reluctantly open the door and I get out of the truck and I start walking across the parking lot. My legs are like wet noodles, you know, and I'm kind of wiping tears away from my eyes because I'm kind of a little bit panicked, obviously. And so as I get closer to this table, I see the woman, one of the women raises her hand and starts pointing at the homeless man. She said, "You see, there's no such thing as coincidence. Everything happens for a reason. I never sit at places like this, but something told me to sit here tonight." And this is what she said as I was passing. And I entered the store and I thought to myself, no way did that woman just say that, you know? Because that was exactly the synopsis of this book, The Kybalion, by the three initiates.
Wow.
Yeah.
The Kybalion. Well, I'm going to certainly read The Kybalion. I know that a lot of my listeners will, too. So you go in the store. I mean, you're like in the, you're in the Twilight Zone at this point. No question about it.
Yeah.
What do you do next? What's your...
So I go back and I get my drink. I'm standing there in line and I actually thought to myself, you know, this has got to be it, for tonight. Cause I don't think I can handle anymore. You know, this is too much, becoming too much. So, this feeling washes over me that, okay, you've figured it out. You heard what you had to hear. And that's going to be it. So I went home and I went to bed, you know, but the next day, all I could think about was this book, The Kybalion, and about how I had to read it. So I did read it. I read it several times. And I thought to myself, you know, there's something very significant going on here. One of the things that the book states is that, you know, the universe is a singular consciousness. And that we all are just extensions of that singular consciousness. And I had a really hard time wrapping my mind around that, because it seems to imply that, you know, this singular consciousness is what we would refer to as God or something like that. But I was an atheist. So, you know, I thought, well, this is kind of a bold statement. And I don't know how you could ever prove that or even know that for yourself or how you could even come to that conclusion. You know, it just seemed a bit out there. And yet I couldn't immediately discount it because of the nature of events that had led me to this book. And so this book was published by a man named William Walker Atkinson. He was one of the authors, and he had a publishing company called the Yogi Publication Society. Back around 1910 is when he wrote The Kybalion. And Mabel Collins was actually one of the authors who also published under that same publishing company. And that's how I came across her book as well.
So you're home at this point and you realize that you've been basically, you're being led in a kind of way. And those two people, the two beautifully dressed women and the homeless man, the three people, are like something on a stage. And, you know, it's hard to know if they themselves knew anything about what was going on. And it may be that the comment the woman made was for you, but also for her and her friend and the homeless man. In other words, they may have been players in a game as well on a stage. There's a real sense of being on a stage here, and it's kind of eerie. Terry, you have had a lot of experience with non-human entities and with people. I think you have. I'm not sure who are somehow connected with this in funny ways. If I'm right about that, tell us about some of those people that you've met that seem to have a sort of occult connection to this whole thing. Or otherwise, tell us about the entity that you've been involved with.
The entity that I've been involved with since I was a young child. Back when I was a child, I called her Sue. I called her Sue because she reminded me in a lot of ways of a Asian woman who lived in back of us, who we all called Sue. And, I had a fondness for her, still do, because she's appeared to me in multiple times over my lifetime. And every time I have an interaction with her, it feels like I'm keeping an appointment.
Like Matthew kept an appointment at the gas station.
Yes. I think Matthew did keep an appointment at the gas station.
Exactly.
And I think my friend Tobias and I kept an appointment when we went to Devil's Den in 1977.
Yeah.
So, yeah, when I have contact with non-human entities, the sporadic that I've had, afterward, I have mixed emotions, mixed up emotions. And when I see the entity Betty or Sue, Betty Sue.
Betty Sue got married to you.
Yeah, it feels that way.
Right.
And, you know, I've had this fondness for her in kind of a maternal way.
And
I'm always glad to see her. But, you know, afterward, it's still upsetting.
What exactly does she look like?
She looks about 4 feet plus in height. She has long limbs. The last time I saw her was in 2019. And she always appears in the same way. And I don't know if this is her actual appearance or if this is a screen appearance or what. And she looks exactly as she did when I was 4, 5, and 6 years old and they would take me. And she has a pencil thin neck and she usually wears a scarf around it. She has really no cartilage or ears to speak of, just a bump for a nose, two nostrils, a slit for a mouth, always communicates telepathically. And, you know, with a wig and some sunglasses and maybe a 1-inch heel to give her some height and the proper outfit to disguise her long arms, she could walk down the streets of Dallas and probably not draw a second look. But if you take off the wig and you see the back of her head, because a human wig won't fit her head properly, it'll be askew because she has a bulbous back to her head with a small crease down the back of her head. So it's like in two lobes. So that's what she looks like.
Wow. And this is so fascinating. That, you know, you would have this intimate experience and over a lifetime of direct physical contact. There's a case where one of the editors at William Morrow and Company, who published my book Communion, encountered just such an entity, two of them, in a bookstore in Manhattan, looking through my book and actually laughing at it, which my editor, when he called me to tell me the story, said, "Well, I have good news and bad news." And I said, "Jim, tell me the bad news first, of course." And he said, "Well, the visitors think your book's ridiculous." I thought, what? The people in Morrow don't even believe it's real. And I said, "Well, what's the good news?" And he told me the story of the other editor, who was incidentally an intelligence officer. I had been in his before he retired. And he said that I talked to this man, and he said, you know, they walked off down the street and they were wearing overcoats and scarves and hats and dark glasses. And, you know, you have to wonder who we meet unaware sometimes in the street, don't you? Go ahead.
I was just to say real quick, in 2007, my wife and I were in Chicago. I was there for business, and we were in the Barnes & Noble bookstore downtown. And I was looking at a book in the esoteric area and the store was crowded. It was 2 weeks before Christmas. And what appeared to be a homeless woman walked up to me and said, "They used to take you too, didn't they?" And turned around and walked away from me. And I tried to find my wife, and I tried to follow and find this woman, and I lost her in the crowd. And that's the only time I've ever had an experience like that, but it was amazing.
You know, I have had a man show up in my life, a human being who's involved in this somehow for years. As you know, Terry, but I don't think you do, Matthew, I have an implant in my left ear that he was responsible for putting in May of 1989. And most recently, about 6 months ago, a doctor that Terry and I both know well decided he wanted to get an x-ray of the implant. And the guy showed up a couple of nights before to explain how it all worked and to tell me not to get it removed. And so... But he's a human being. Now, Matthew, let's get back to this situation, because you're kind of on the edge of a cliff at this point. You go home from this bizarre encounter. What happens next?
I read the Kabbalion next. I read it several times, and I thought to myself, you know, I'm not sure what all of this is. I kind of feel like maybe this is some kind of learning experience. So I think to myself, well, I'm ready for more experiences from which I can learn. Nothing was farther from the truth, because I wasn't really expecting what happened next at all. what happened next was that was when I started to see non-human entities in my room at night.
Tell us about the first of those experiences.
Yeah. So I had gone out to some kind of a work function. It was out in town, so I was supposed to have brought civilian clothes to work to change. I didn't, so I had to run home and get out of my uniform, put on some civilian clothes. And so in doing so, I changed very quickly, and I threw my shirt over the open closet door in my room, which is not something I like to do because it's kind of sloppy, you know. I get home that night. I got home late. I was laying in bed, you know, and I was exhausted. And I saw the closet door is open and my shirt's hanging over it. And I don't like to leave things that way. So, but I thought, I'll take care of it tomorrow, you know? Well, anyway, at some point that night I woke up because there was, someone grabbing my arm in the middle of the night.
So familiar. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I was laying in bed. I opened my eyes. I'm on my back and I don't sleep on my back. And I'm looking at the window off to my left and it starts to get like I can't see as much detail in it anymore. It's starting to go blurry. So I went to go lift my hand to my eyes and kind of rub the sleep out of my eyes. And I realized I couldn't do that. I couldn't move. My hand just kind of flopped at my side. I felt like my body weighed 1,000 pounds. And then I remembered, wait, I woke up because someone's grabbing my arm and I can still feel their hand on my arm. So I kind of fight to turn my head to the right. And as I'm doing this, my vision is getting blurrier and blurrier. I see this shadow outline of a person, you know, standing over me. I see a head, a torso, and two arms kind of standing over me in this black shadow figure looking person, you know. So as I'm looking at this, I think to myself, you know, I should be terrified that there's someone in my room right now. And I'm not really terrified. I didn't really feel anything. I was just kind of more puzzled, really. And as I'm looking at this, all of a sudden behind this figure, this golden light starts to illuminate my room. It becomes so bright that it's like blinding. And then all of a sudden that golden light are these rays of light coming out of its head. All of a sudden, I see as though there's like a tablet or something in front of this person's face, an image appears and it starts flipping through images of people that I know. And it stops on the image of an ex of mine from 20 years ago. And I thought to myself, what is going on? You know, this is like the most bizarre thing I've ever seen.
Yeah. That would qualify, no question.
Yeah, so I lose consciousness and I kind of fall back asleep, and then I'm having this dream of me and my ex from 20 years ago, and it's kind of a sexual dream, you know. And this dream was unusual in that, you know, it was me and my ex, and we were surrounded by nothing. But darkness, you know, there's nothing around us. There was no floor. There was no bed. There was nothing. And then all of a sudden, like I open my eyes and I'm back in my room and I can see that there is a woman kind of on top of me and my hands are on her thighs and she has blue skin and her skin, I can feel her thighs and it's not like normal human skin. It was much thicker skin. It was smoother. So I knew that she was not human.
That would be my immediate conclusion too.
Yeah. So I tried to scan up towards her face and her face was just blurry. It was blurry. I couldn't see her face. I guess she wouldn't let me see it. I don't know exactly what that was all about.
You know, I've had such a similar experience with someone who was not human, a woman on me, and her face was blacked out. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you didn't know that because you've not read my books.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it's so interesting, isn't it, folks? We're talking together about these ultra high level strangeness experiences. And the three of us keep finding these similarities. That means a lot, actually. It means a great deal. It means that something is really happening here. It can't be blown off as, you know, drugs or hypnosis, or I've personally never done drugs in my life, or false memories or anything like that. There's something going on that is stranger than strange. And the strangest thing I can think of right now is that, Free Dreamlanders, you've got to leave us, because we're just getting into this incredible story. Go in to unknowncountry.com and subscribe, but also do two other things. You must not fail to get Matthew's book, Initiated. It is about a process of initiation. He went into it very deeply. He understood it in the context of the Greek gods and ancient ideas of the journey of the soul. Okay, so, and Terry Lovelace and I will be at Contact in the Desert the weekend of June the 25th. Terry's website is terrylovelace.com. You should, if you have not checked out Incident at Devil's Den, it's time to get into this, because something is in the process of being discovered.
Well, the government is admitting that there's a mystery in the skies at last. We've known that for a long time. There's also a mystery down here among us, because somebody is not only flying around, somebody is right in our own lives, in our own bedrooms, and in the lives of our families, and we all know it very well. Next week on Dreamland, Jacques Vallée, Paola Harris, Trinity, the discovery of an unknown UFO crash from 1945. Startling new information, brilliantly researched by Jacques and Paola. Don't miss it. It's going to be a very exciting show.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.